This is the Focus Group with Business Insider's Tim Bennett and John Nash.
I fought worse monsters than you for years in Hollywood. I know how to win the hard way.
We're all business, except when we're not.
Don't f*** with me, fellas! This ain't my first time at the rodeo.
Hey, welcome to the Focus Group. John Nash here with my good friend and co-host Tim Bennett. We're all business except when we're not. You may hear us use that tagline quite often, almost like beating a dead horse into the ground because we paid for it.
Paid for it. You got to use it.
You can find us on most every platform, iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Google Play, and of course, YouTube, which I think is a lot of fun because if you're tuning into the YouTube channel, you get to see a lot of the graphics that we curate and provide for the visual experience. Focus Group Radio is the handle for all things social media. That includes Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and LinkedIn. And we also have a phone number. You could reach us at 914-362-8747 or 914-FUCUS, Focus, G-R, Focus, GR. You could leave a comment for us or a question. And we have a segment that we do called Ask Tim and John. And if you leave a question for us, and we don't know, our producer picks the question, it will get asked while we're recording, you'll get a pair of our famous Focus Group radio socks. So, here we are on the eve of New York City Pride.
Tim. Happy Pride, John.
Happy Pride. We are back from our trip to the Gay Wine Weekend out in Sonoma, which was called Out in the Vineyard. We are going to do actually a special wrap-up of our trip that we'll release on Wednesday, I think. And it will have
Wednesday
pictures and descriptions. We also, Tim, super cool Tim, got us a tour of the Jelly Belly factory out in, what town was that?
It's Fairfield, California, which is only about 20 minutes from Sonoma. So the great thing is if you have kids and you're out in wine country and you're looking for something else to do
besides
during the day
wine,
if you get wined out, it's a great tour. And they just did a new tour, so we got to experience it.
There you go. And actually, we were the day before. They were soft launching the new tour.
Right.
And we had we had a hilarious time. And I think actually the luck of that was going with two executives who really were passionate about the...
We get a very different experience about it. So that was pretty cool. So on today's show, we have joining us Joe Putignano, who wrote a book called Acrobatic. You can see it here. And it's about his life. It's a memoir that's actually quite revealing and talks about his quest to be a world-class gymnast, but was derailed by drug addiction, particularly heroin. So he's going to come in and talk to us about that. Not that it's a downer, because I think it's a happy ending. So.
Yeah, I was just going to say, the book has a really uplifting message to it.
So he'll be joining us later on in the show. I had a question for you, John.
Yes.
So I went to a dinner party this weekend, or this week, when I got back. And the people invited me over to eat. They had a number of friends over to eat. And they served a casserole-y chicken parm sort of dish with the cheese and the red sauce. And we sit down to eat, and then the person that was having the party sat down with a piece of filet steak.
All right.
And
so, am I supposed to guess that they're like on the Atkins diet or something?
No. I just I thought it was the elephant in the room. So there's six of us dishing out this chicken breast with the
chicken parmesan
and red sauce. And he sits down with a beautiful filet and some string beans and a potato. So I looked, and I'm looking around at everybody else to see what's going on. So I said something. I said, was there a choice to have to eat? He said, no, this was left over from another night. But is it me that doesn't think – is it weird? I think that's weird.
I rank that without even thinking about it as the weird column. Yeah. If you're serving a dinner – to multiple people.
Right.
You're all pretty much going to have the same thing.
You all did. Five of us did.
Unless you do something where someone says, if you're coming to tomorrow night, you have a choice of tuna or beef.
Right.
I'll have a tuna steak, whatever. But that's like even someone's barbecuing on your back porch or something.
So it's not my
imagination.
That's weird. Because we had a delightful dinner with your sister and your sister Laura and her husband Steve and your niece Kit Kat.
As my mom says, you got to see the Volovskis.
Yes.
She could have just said my sister.
That was a fun stop. That was one of the highlights.
And I want to tell you that every one of them, Steve, Laura, and Kit Kat, Catherine, chimed in that they had loved seeing you. They haven't got to spend time with you in a long time. It should be said that my younger sister, Laura, used to pal around with Tim and I.
Yes.
When we were in high school, she'd bag along down to the, well, where would we go? We'd go to Carvel, McDonald's, right. Basic stuff.
Mayo's
right?
Or whatever. The last time I think I spent any length of time, and your nieces were
tiny.
Tiny, yeah. Sitting on, kneeling on bar stools, dipping pretzels into Nutella.
That was up at Cape Cod.
Cape Cod. This is the last time
you
I saw them.
You taught them how to do that.
So I was thinking, gosh, it's been that long. But it was great to see them. Yeah. So
and of
was
course,
a fun stop.
Steve, we're leaving the, they're moving back east, but they live in San Francisco, San Rafael. And where the car is pulling out, we're heading to the airport to take our red eyes home. And I said, boy, that was fun. And Tim goes, yeah, yeah. And by the way, your brother-in-law says you should ditch the T-shirt.
Yeah.
Because I often wear like a white T-shirt. And you know what? I thought, he's probably right.
Well, you and I always, that's how I used to be able to tell the Americans from everyone else in Europe. We always had white T-shirts on underneath. And even when I would travel for work, it's a dead giveaway that you're an American. If you have a white T-shirt underneath, so when I would travel to Japan or to Europe, if you saw a guy with either a shirt like this or a polo shirt or something with a white T-shirt, like we always did, American, there's an American. That or a backpack, lesbian fanny pack.
Maybe I have to invest in some V-necks. I happen to like, I'll be honest with you, I like a T-shirt. I like that white line. I like that crisp.
Oh, I do too, but it's very much a preppy thing. But yeah. I was not at the Vavlovskys.
Vavlovskys.
The Vavlovskys' house.
Aren't my people.
20 seconds, and Steve pulls me over and goes, tell Nash to lose the white T-shirt. So that was fun.
I love him.
Yeah.
So we had a good time. We had a very good time. It was a fun trip. And as I said, we'll have a Wednesday show that we're going to do. It's a 15, 20-minute wrap-up of Out in the Vineyard. We'll share some pictures and also a lot of stories with the founders, Gary and Mark. So be sure to look for that.
Yeah.
So what caught your eye this week?
So this week, this is a very, very quick one. I don't know if you heard about this. It happened in Edgewater, Colorado. And the headline is, drunk diner drops huge tip, but then comes back the next day and asks for it.
So it was an accidental tip.
Well, so the workers, this was a restaurant called Thai-licious in Edgewater. And the owners, you can see a picture there if you're watching on YouTube. But so some guy had come in. He was apparently drunk, quite drunk.
Mm-hmm.
And he thought he was handing out ones, and he was handing out hundreds. And so he left. It was a $60 bill.
But I'm just going to hit the pause button for a minute. Do you carry around hundreds?
Well, you never know if you see something nice. You know, I do have some, yeah.
But
I have $2 bills, too.
Enough that you would confuse them for ones. I mean, singles, you could have like 9 singles in your wallet. You could have 8. You could have 10.
Well, if you're totally, you know, lit up. Yeah. So he was, okay. He thought he was doing 12.
Oh, my God.
So, 1, 2, 3, boy, you're going to leave 12 singles. Anyway, the owners were smart enough. So the tip was $1,088 is what the tip ended up being. And so
they actually like sequester it or keep it.
Well, what the owners did is they said that the serving staff felt they hit the lottery. They just thought it was fantastic. They said they felt like millionaires. So the two owners were smart and they said, you know what, don't spend it and hold on to it. Because this just seems to be really weird. Unless the guy's some kind of eccentric millionaire. You hear about that where people will leave a big tip.
Only at Christmas. You only hear about those guys that go out and hand out $100 bills at like a Walmart and people cry, my life's made, I could buy Barbie for my kids.
So sure enough, he came back and he said that he thought he was giving them $1 notes instead of $100 bills. He said it turns out he had drank a little too much alcohol and mistakenly stuffed the cash inside the checkbook thing that, you know, the check thing that you get, according to the Denver Post. So his meal was only $60. He did end up leaving a $40 tip. But what the owner said is luckily she told the employees to keep hold of the money. And they were able to pay him back immediately when he came in. And
that's smart.
He said service was good, but just not that good. But I don't know. I think if you play it, it's like gambling. I can't go to the casino and say, you know what, I only made $10.
Oh, wait. And the ball, the roulette.
Oops, that was, oh, is that a wrong number?
It drops into 3 red. Oh, no, I want in 5. Give me the, yeah.
What happened to you and I at the rent-a-car in San Francisco? I put, and I blame Hertz for this, and I want to call Hertz. I put, return the car at 9:30. Now, they had my flight information knowing I had a 10:30 flight.
Oh, yeah.
So all of a sudden, the rent-a-car is twice as much money, and the guy says, well, you said you were going to return at 9:30 in the morning. I said, I don't remember that option being for AM. Anyway, same sort of thing. I could have, so.
They basically charged you for like a half day or a couple hours extra.
You're just kind of, you know me, I get, I'm a dog with a bone.
I just, because they're like the person that does the barcode, checks the gas, they're not going to change the, they can't do that.
I would have said to this guy, I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, they also got you by the cojones.
If you're that drunk, if you were drunk enough to not know you were doling out $1,200,
rental car, you're back to
Tyler. I'm saying, it's like saying, I meant to do. Yeah. So if you're drunk enough to hand out hundreds, then how do you remember where you did it? So anyway, I thought it was awful nice of the restaurant to give it back. I would have played stupid, probably.
Hmm.
What would you have done?
I think they did the smart thing, but that it seems so weird that you would, like how delicious was a chicken pad thai that he, you know what I mean? I'm just saying, you know, it's like.
You're too nice once again. What caught your eye?
Well, what caught my eye was actually something that occurred in the airport coming back from our Sonoma trip. And, you know, we're still in the shadow of this horrible event in Orlando, and in fact, we talked about it. We did a radio show out in Sonoma. We were on the Gay Wine or Gary's Out in the Vineyard show. I don't have much to say about it except that I'm numb, and I think a lot of other far more eloquent people have spoken about it. You know, the loss of life, the loss of a future for all those great individuals is something we can't even put into words. So I'm getting off the plane. And I'm walking down the at JFK Delta Terminal's huge. If you land at one end of it, you might as well take a shuttle, you know, to get all the way to the baggage. So I'm walking by all these empty Delta gates, you know, the ones that are just sitting waiting for passengers. And on the gate, on the boards of each gate that you're walking by, or Delta had this graphic up, and it has one of the. It says Orlando, we stand with Orlando, and. It's the AIDS ribbon, and part of it's the rainbow, and part of it's an American flag. And all just said, so as you're watching, it's very, in other words, very powerful statement to me. The reason it caught my eye is because the minute I saw it on like five gates in a row, it was just holding up there. It reminded me of the feeling I would have when I would see a corporation advertise in Out of the Advocate. Back in the at the height of the HIV/AIDS crisis, right. So we're talking late '80s, probably early to mid '90s. It was like an eye opener. You're like, wow, you know. And I was instantly thought, wow, Delta. Our politicians have made some pretty grotesque statements. Religious leaders have said heinous things about this. I read something the other day about a minister who said that someone should go finish the job. Like, how do you even say stuff like this? So to have a corporation. Actually, just put up something as positive as we stand with Orlando. It's just a night.
Well, you and I have always said corporations have always led the way for a social change, haven't they?
They have. Now, there's a couple other examples of corporations. Target did something recently for anti-bullying effort. I forget what the text was.
Spirit Day.
That's it. There's a take pride in what you stand for and who you stand by. And recently, Starbucks put up on their Facebook page something I thought was kind of cute. I just grabbed a still of it, but they have a video of a pride flag on top of the Starbucks headquarters.
Oh, wow.
And the video just shows the wind waving the flag.
Wow, so, that's pretty cool.
So I just give a big thumbs up to that kind of a gesture by corporations and corporate America. And, you know, Delta has been a large supporter of the LGBT community for a long time. So, and the immediacy and how quickly that came in. So that's what caught my eye.
Can I sidebar Delta for a second and ask you two questions? Did you notice when they were doing the instructions before you take off how they've changed the wording?
Yes.
What did you notice?
In terms of the new video they play?
Well, no, it wasn't with the flight attendants say, you know, please stay seated with your seatbelt fastened in case we encounter rough air. Rough air.
They don't say turbulence anymore.
Yeah, it's rough air.
Rough air.
Which I laughed. And then twice I heard, thank you for jet setting with us.
Jet setting.
I thought that was hilarious.
I heard the jet setting things a couple times.
Yeah, jet setting. Jet setting. You're jet setting along jet setting, the, which is so campy. So there must be a gay person in marketing.
The weekend history.
Weekend history. Today, John, the 25th, Saturday, aside from being happy pride in a lot of places.
Happy pride.
I don't know if this.
Top of the pride.
I don't know if this
pride
is.
Pride leprechaun.
Yeah, I don't know if this is a correlation, but it's catfish day.
All right, so if you're watching YouTube, John, by the way, we want to thank John and Garrett our fabulous techs who keep us on the die.
So catfish.
So someone makes this. That's like Sharknado.
I don't know what that is. It's a catfish.
A picture of a cat and a fish all in one.
You know, 95% of our catfish comes from Mississippi, Arkansas, Alabama, and Louisiana. And it's the most sustainable and eco-friendly fish. President Reagan declared National Catfish Day to recognize the importance of catfish farming way back in 1987.
Okay, all right.
The 1867, Lucien Smith patented the first barbed wire. And then you remember our trip. So you this was also going to be in your week.
This is going to be week in science.
And I didn't know why this was a science thing, and you said engineering feat.
Engineering feat.
So, went to the Devil's Rope Museum in McLean, Texas. If you're on Route 66, please do it.
And so we did a road trip back about 4 or 5 years ago, a turbo diesel Beetle. You
know, with Volkswagen, yeah.
Love that car. And we went around this building about twice. The lights were off. We went in. They click, 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 and all the fluorescent lights come on. And it's a museum dedicated to barbed wire.
Well, it looked like there was an old Crown Vic and a Taurus sitting in the lot, like, all dusty, dirty, with tumbleweeds and a dog with...
And there was a dog that looked like it had an nipples.
And I'm like, John's like, we're going in. I said, not me. We went in.
Let's go in.
Saw your friend Alta there.
Alta, and that's John and Alta. Yeah. And I put a picture of Tim in front of the... I guess people used to carry around those little miniature fences, salesman samples of barbed wire. You could have the triple wire. You could have this. And Alta was, she was wise.
She combed her hair and put her makeup on before we took her picture.
I love her, yeah.
She had your number. This goes in the So What column. 1951 in New York, the very first commercial color TV transmissions were presented on CBS through the CBS color system. But the public didn't have color TVs at the time.
So did you personally make up the So What category?
I did.
Good. So that's the So What category. Yeah. Okay, I like that.
1993, Kim Campbell, way ahead of us. She was the very first Canadian prime minister. She took office in 1993 when Brian Mulroney had decided to resign. 1998, the Supreme Court ruled that those infected with HIV would be protected under the Americans with Disabilities Act, which was a good thing. This is for you, John. Sunday, June 26, 1819, the bicycle was patented by W.K. Clarkson, Jr. I couldn't find a picture of it.
I saw that in the Week in Science as well, and I tried to find a picture, couldn't find. Yeah, that's...
I guess we're 1819.
You and I had the same problem.
Had to draw it. Trivia question for you. Who was the first president to marry in office? Do you know?
To marry in office?
Yeah.
I should know
this. I didn't know this.
You didn't know this?
No, I had no idea. John Tyler, our 10th president, married Julia Gardner. And though she was not in the White House long, she made a real impact. She considered herself royalty.
Why? Because she was marrying the president?
She had. She's the one who is responsible for Hail to the Chief. That's played for the president every time there's state functions. She even had a court of ladies-in-waiting. She and the president apparently liked to dance. She introduced the polka and the waltz to the White House balls. She had a press agent hired to sing her praises. She also, the press often called her Lady Presidentress.
She was like one of the real first housewives.
Right. And then they left the White House, and you can't make it up. They retired to Sherwood Forest.
Where the hell is Sherwood Forest?
Somewhere in the South. She became a mistress of the plantation until the Civil War. She had five of their seven children there. She supported the Confederacy, and in response to ending slavery, she praised slavery as a civilizing influence, and noted that the slaves lived better than the poor in London. Barbara Bush. Remember that, this Houston thing? This is working out for them quite well.
This is working out. Yeah, I remember that. Oof.
So
messy.
That one was kind of crazy. 1974 in Troy, Ohio, Marsh Supermarket installed the very first barcoding system, and Juicy Fruit Gum was the very first product to have a barcode on it.
54.
Yeah, 1974.
74, okay. 74.
1981 in Idaho. This one just makes me crazy when I see these things. Some woman, Virginia Campbell, she took all her coupons and rebates and bought $26,460 worth of groceries for 67 cents. I never understood how they do that. Of course, if you want 15 gallons,
she had
15
all
packages
those coupons?
Of time. Right. How do you get to 67 cents?
That is a boy.
I never get it.
She had double, triple coupons. She had everything going on, right?
Monday, June 27th, Ernest Borgnine in 1964. Ernest Borgnine and Ethel Merman got married. I didn't know they were married.
Ernest Borgnine.
It only lasted 38 days.
Name one of a movie he was in that you liked.
None.
Oh, come on.
I don't know. I can't
remember. Come on, you love some of... All right, the disaster movies.
Poseidon Adventure.
Bingo.
Was he in that?
Yeah, he was in that. Yeah.
Every time you say disaster, Shelley Winters was in there too, wasn't she?
And she gained weight for that movie and never lost it.
That's my problem. I gained weight for the show.
And you never lost it, right? Did you even try? Did you even try?
I'm trying, John. It's very tough. The last one, 1969. This is very obvious to a lot of our listeners. In 1969, patrons at the Stonewall Inn, a gay bar here in New York City, Greenwich Village, clashed with police. The incident is considered the birth of the gay rights movement. So that was 1969. So what happened in science?
Weekend science comes off the iPad.
Doesn't no paper?
You know, I decided that science should be we should use iPads for science.
Oh, okay.
All right. So, okay, on June 26th was born the 5th Earl of Carnarvon. Now, his real name is George Edward Stanhope Molyneux Herbert. He was a British Egyptologist. He dabbled in archaeology as a small boy, digging the park of his ancestral home, Highclere Castle. And Highclere Castle happens to be the site and the set for none other than Downton Abbey.
And why is this week of science?
Because he was born. Oh. He funded Howard Carter's discovery of King Tut's tomb in 1922.
Okay.
So he was so into Egyptology that
you would have been an Egyptologist or an entomologist.
Well, there's a really funny there's an odd story that Carnarvon died because of a curse when they opened King Tut's tomb, that something happened, and Howard Carter, I think, passed away. Carnarvon, they all passed away in really quick succession, and maybe it was the mummy.
Indiana Jones.
Yeah. All right, in 1976, on June 26 as well, the world's tallest self-supporting structure opened to the public, and it's something that is from your native land. Toronto?
CNN.
The CN Tower.
CN
Tower.
That's the tallest structure in Canada?
Freestanding. I think there's a couple of definitions for this. So it's self-supporting structure.
Wow.
It's hollow, actually. Those concrete...
Have you been to that?
Oh, I love it. Did
you go up?
Oh, we went up, and I wanted to do something that Bob forbid me to do. But the height is 1,815, 5 feet inches tall, largest freestanding. There's a thing you could do now that they did, and I wanted to do it. It's called edge walk.
Bob wouldn't let you. Now that you're married, maybe you should consider.
So you get a harness put on you and a jumpsuit, and you walk, and they tether you to this thing that goes. You could walk the whole.
Not me.
And they have you lean out over the thing. I was dying to do it.
John, you're crazy.
I missed it by.
You really would do that?
I'd love to do it. I want to go.
You're not
back
afraid of heights.
No, not really.
Well, you can come clean my gutters.
And look, there's a harness on you. You're not going to fall. You know. I guess you could ask the statistics on the stats.
Have you gone rappelling?
I would love to do that.
Okay. You do rappelling. You tell me how you like it.
And then this is for us going back to our grade school days. In 1978, on June 27, Gillette came out with the erasable pen. Do you remember that packaging?
I love that thing.
Did you like the erasable pen? I didn't like it. The ink, you could rub off sometimes, but I remember I had an eraser on one end. It was such a strange
thing. Well, the problem
thing
with it was if you touched it, you got it on your fingers. Which
yes.
Was part of the
yes,
issue.
Yes, that's exactly right. Yeah.
I love the eraser mate. I used to love that thing.
Gillette. There you go. So that was the week in science.
Business birthdays. We have two of them. We're the only show in the universe that does business birthdays. Born on what are you laughing at now?
We're the only show in the universe.
Universe, right, still, that does business birthdays.
We might be the only planet with life in the universe, so that makes it all that more important to do a business birthday.
Well, you could say Earth, but why not? So Saturday, June 25th, John Orr Young was born. He died in 1976 at 89.
Looks like one of the Marx Brothers.
He was the American, one of the founders of Young and Rubicam, the famous advertising agency, which is celebrating 90 years in business this year. They started way back in the 20s, right at the advent, 1918, way back at the advent of just talkies were happening, radio, commercial radio. And they said one of the actual biggest game changers in media at the time was the start of the Young and Rubicam agency. And they started in Philadelphia initially. One of their first accounts was Crisco. And then,
so that's why. Okay, so if you're watching us on YouTube, Tim, I recognize that
that's
fist.
That's the fist in Detroit.
That's in Detroit. Uh-huh. That's a funny picture. That's a very funny picture.
Well, we could just do a can of Crisco, but why not?
That. Well, how do you know how you found that? That's a good one.
And they built themselves up to be quite an agency, and they were given a lot of challenging assignments. But one of the big ones, and I don't remember this. Postum. Do you remember Postum?
Yeah, Postum was like a fiber kind of thing. Or
so they had an $800,000 budget in 1926, which was huge for a brand to have $800,000. It was a they were trying to figure out how it's a coffee substitute made from wheat.
Oh,
it was free of caffeine.
That's what Postum is.
Right. It was free of caffeine, and many people found it also free of taste. So sales were in a steep decline, but they ended up doing all these gut-wrenching ads with headlines like "Why Men Crack," and it dramatized the dangers of drinking coffee. So because they did so successful with that, they ended up getting the Jell-O account as well. But they started the Gallup poll. They hired George Gallup.
They started Gallup?
There's a lot of, you know, there's so much that's written about Young and Rubicam. Actually, they also are responsible for what is known as Madison Avenue, where all the advertisers were. So there's a lot to be said for that. So happy birthday, John. And then on Monday, June 27th, one of my favorite characters is 86 years old, Ross Perot. And you remember Ross Perot? He was the American businessman best known for being an independent presidential candidate in 92 for the Reform Party. Right.
Spoiler.
They blame him for electing Clinton, which actually I don't think was such a bad thing. He founded EDS, which he sold to General Motors in 84.
That's right. Big data processing.
He sold it for over $2 billion. He's got an estimated worth of $4.1 billion. The 129th richest person in the U.S. He started at IBM as a salesman. He did all of his quota in 2 weeks. He had a yearly quota to sell. He got it done in 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
And he went to he said the people at IBM wouldn't listen to him. He had a bunch of ideas, so he went out and started EDS. He had 77 no's before somebody finally gave him a contract. So he talks about perseverance. And he also was a funder of Steve Jobs. He said he missed out with Bill Gates, and so Steve Jobs, he became an angel investor, $20 million
Fascinating.
When he left Apple. Yeah, I didn't either. He's got some great quotes. One of my favorite ones was, "Be careful about picking a fight with the people who buy ink by the barrel and paper by the ton." So, and then the other
careful
one.
Careful with picking a fight.
Be careful about picking a fight with the people who buy ink by the barrel and paper by the ton. And then there's the other one, which I think you and I laugh about this. "I haven't sold anybody over lunch in my whole life. There's nothing worse than trying to drive a point home when someone's fiddling with a salad." Then he said to General Motors, "It takes 5 years for you to develop a new car. Heck, we won World War II in 4 years." So,
interesting point.
Happy birthday, Ross.
My favorite Ross Perot, could you guess? It's just
the debate.
It's an image. There's an image of Ross Perot that will forever be in my mind, and it was courtesy of Time Magazine.
I don't
remember that cover. It had Clinton and Bush, and then Perot was looking up over the bottom of just his head and his nose. Remember this at all?
I don't remember that.
Oh my God, I gotta find that somewhere. It was a classic.
My favorite line, and I couldn't find it, but my favorite line of his during the debate with Clinton was, he accused when Bill Clinton said, you know, he was governor of Arkansas. And he said, "I don't know what you know about running a budget. The whole budget of Arkansas falls somewhere between Dole Bananas and Toys R Us."
And he had charts. Everything. Pie charts.
He was actually, I don't know if you remember Timberland.
Oh, hey. John found it.
Oh, well, is that it? There he is.
Look at how they did him. They put him with the little nose, right? They did it.
Spoiler.
That's great. Thank you, John.
You remember Dennis McLean from Timberland McLean. He was the advertising guy, and Timberland did a lot of pro bono work for Ross Perot. And their stories are fascinating about traveling with him with these charts and stuff. So
he was a funny,
interesting
guy.
Hey, it's the Focus Group with Tim Bennett and John Nash. Be sure to follow along with us. Find us on all platforms at focusgroupradio.com. Be sure to like us, subscribe to us, and rate.
You had it last week. You were
subscribe, right. We'll be right back with Joe Putignano, who's going to talk to us about his book Acrobatics. So stay with us.
The Focus Group is brought to you by the newly redesigned Volkswagen Passat. It's time to give your family a serious upgrade. Visit VW.com to learn more.
Focus on the savvy side of 9 to 5 with the Focus Group.
Been in business a week. I got more money than I know what to do with.
Listen, laugh, and learn with Tim and John.
Herrera Rocher. He is doing well.
Hey, welcome back to Focus Group. John Nash with my good friend and co-host Tim Bennett. Find us everywhere where quality media is consumed. iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Google Play, and of course on YouTube. And on iTunes, Tim likes to say, subscribe, like, and rate.
Yeah, but I think it should be a different order.
I gotta go back and find that quote now. Do you think it's gonna rate us, subscribe?
No.
We're the branding guys. We should know how to do this. Hey, joining us now is author of a book called Acrobatic, Joe Putignano.
Oh, wow.
Got it. Well, I've only said it like 1,000 times
before
the show starts. I'm like, Joe, I gotta say your name a million times. Joe, are you currently with Cirque du Soleil?
No, I left 2 years ago. Actually.
And what are you doing now?
I am in school to be a nurse practitioner. So.
Excellent. Yes. So could I say that you were a contortionist?
You could, yeah. <That's> exactly.
And
yeah.
What is a contortionist?
Well, it's weird. It's different with like each country actually. Because contortionists are usually like Mongolian or even Ukraine or Russian, trained from an early age. But here in the U.S., it's someone who's trained as very, very flexible. Beyond, you know, human capabilities, kind of. So I guess that's the best definition of a contortionist. Very flexible person.
So in your book, The Acrobatic, and this came out, was it a year and a half, 2 years ago?
Yes.
Okay. The pretty revealing book. John and I was reading it during our travels. And as a young kid, very young, you had this fascination with gymnastics.
Yeah, and a gift, I would say, from what I gleaned.
Yeah, and how did that come about?
I was watching the 1984 Olympics. I think it was like Bart Connor and Mary Lou Retton.
Right.
Yeah.
Good squad. The guys look good. I remember the guys looking good on that squad. Anyway, sorry.
We watched it in your basement.
Yeah,
I remember.
Well, it was in my basement actually. It was young, and it was like I was struck by lightning. Like I knew that's what I wanted to do with the rest of my life, and just like a you know pianist who hits the keys and knows this is what they're supposed to do,
right.
It immediately like called to me, and I took the cushions off the couch and started flipping, and I realized I was really good at this. It was like I had done it in almost like a past life, which I know sounds weird, but. It was intuitive.
Well, you have a lot of that in the book, kind of a I don't want to say fantasy or metaphysical sort of thing, where there, or is that right, or did I not read into that correctly?
About gymnastics or?
About your feelings about knowing people, or you had a very intuitive way about you?
Yes. Well, I'm a Cancer. I think that just comes with it. But I do. It's I'm very emotional, so I pick up on emotion very quickly, and not only just pick up on it, I feel what other people feel. It's a kind of a curse at times.
Well, because you were a black sheep. Were you the black sheep of your family?
Actually, my sister Jen was the black sheep, and then I became the black sheep. I was the younger star, kind of. They were all alcoholic from Boston. And I was the one bringing the hope. And then that completely shattered by the time I was about 16.
So if we sidebar there and say bringing the hope means this insight and this inspiration with gymnastics led you to start training.
Yes.
And to pursue it as an actual career and as an athletic endeavor. And you ended up going into the, you know, training with the Olympic, at the Olympic, the U.S. training facilities, right?
Yes, yeah.
And it was there that a lot of the problems began, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, at any, like, 15 years, 16-year-old is going to have problems. For me, that's when it really started, this darkness and depression. I think it was mostly me being gay, not coming to terms with that, but some other stuff. You know, addiction runs in my family, and I couldn't properly tell anybody about it because my family, they
but,
are
but where, addicts. But where did it actually stem from? Because when you talk about in the book this notion of perfection.
Mm-hmm.
Was it being drilled into you by coaches or by observing other people and how come I can't do it like that or why are they succeeding? Or like if your was your natural ability somehow betraying you in the end? Or
it's both. Gymnastics is a kind of sport where you're scored and everyone sees your score. It's not just personal. So those are like your character defects. And when they show up a 9.5 and a 10.0 is perfect, then you did something wrong. When you do that over and over and over, that starts to bleed into every aspect of your life. So I wanted, you know, never to feel shame. So I had to get perfect everywhere I went. Otherwise, I was doing something wrong. So I think that for me, the sport and what I was dealing with, I just didn't cope well. You know, in retrospect, I wish I had more supportive people to kind of guide me through what I was dealing with.
That was going
to
be something I'm curious about, because coaches end up being surrogate parents.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that at that age, one of the gifts they possessed was recognizing when one of their athletes is either not interpreting direction correctly, needs a break, needs the reality button reset, like, hey, this is 10 is 10, 9.9 is 9, you know, like to give you perspective.
Mm-hmm.
But you didn't have that around you?
I did a little bit from one coach, and he did see that I was starting to drink, and he was like,
really?
What are you doing?
And you're 16?
Yes.
Wow.
I mean, my parents owned a bar in Boston, and he knew they were alcoholic, and he actually tried to get me to go live with him, and my father intervened, and he's like, no. So then he backed off, and he was a, you know, he was just trying to help. We're still in touch, and he just knew I was going down the path, and he couldn't stop it, and it got progressively worse.
In retrospect, when you look at it, because you mentioned that you came to the realization about your sexuality,
mm-hmm.
but do you think a lot of this almost obsession with perfection and proving yourself, whether it was to your family or to yourself or friends, was hidden out of shame of being gay?
Oh, absolutely. You know, The Velvet Rage book speaks all about this, that we do live in a straight world, so we are not just competing with ourselves, we are trying to compete with what people consider the norm. So we're always going to work harder, no matter what, to be seen as normal. And I knew that. I didn't know I was gay, I knew I was different.
Right.
And I talked about that early in the book, that there was this invisible line that I couldn't see, that I would cross, but the other, you know, boys in my class didn't. It's like they knew not to be as emotional as I was. It was weird.
Oh, that's interesting, because the traditional masculine template, which has hopefully evolved a bit in the last couple of years, but that was like cold exterior. You could show a little bit of emotion, but you didn't want to go too far, right?
Right.
But I saw a little, you and I had talked about this in the car once, and you were actually surprised when I told you that I was nowhere near the Olympic level, but in rowing in college, I had something to prove because I was deeply closeted, made fun of, picked on, and my thought was, I have to really prove that I can do this,
mm-hmm.
and did everything I could to make sure that I made the team and did what I need to do. So I saw a lot of that in your book, and that there becomes a point where you either succeed in that or you take the wrong turn, and you took the wrong turn.
Yeah.
So,
you know, I how you go, and I don't mean to, you know, how you go from this incredible gift that you possess of physicality with your body, you had to, you didn't have to, but part of you might have suspected that treating your body the way you ended up doing, which we read about in the book, was totally, you know, contrary to being this incredible physical person, right?
Yeah. Because I was growing up in an alcoholic home, I had seen the destruction. I mean, and this is why we say addiction is a disease. I mean, if anybody had the best reason not to drink, it was me. I saw what it did to everyone in my family. But self-knowledge avails us nothing. And once I started, I couldn't stop. And it was amazing because the drink eliminated the perfection. And so the perfection was choking me. So this was relief. This was a solution, you know. It was like, this I can live with.
Or was it rebellion?
There was a little bit of both. You know, there's always teen angst in our teens. But and so, yeah, you take it as far as you can go. But by then, like, this was a solution. Like, I was not going to live without it until I couldn't, really.
So how did you, you eventually ended up, would you say you were a heroin addict?
Oh, yeah.
How did you continue to work and perform, and did people know that you were that? Because we've all, unfortunately, and this election really has brought it to light about the people going from opiates into the heroin addiction, which is unfortunately very prevalent now in society. But how did you function? Because a lot of people just haven't been able to.
Right, I didn't function well. I thought I was, and people knew. Beginning of my addiction. I was a waiter, and then I got a job at the New York Times. I was working for the New York Times for about 4 years. And you know, it was like taking medicine three times a day. I would shoot up. I worked on the news desk, which was like circular, kind of like this. And when I would nod out and start to fall asleep, I'd put the paper, open it up, and start to fall asleep into it because we're supposed to read the paper. So I did things like that. You know, I would throw up in the hallway. Yeah, well, that's the thing. You learn behaviors. How to get as high as you can without anyone noticing. But I messed up. I mean, so many times, you know, you do too much. You don't have it. You're sick. It was like living with a nightmare, you know, 24 hours a day.
Or in one, yeah.
Where did you shoot in your arm or?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I know where you're going. I can't figure that. I to be honest with you, I don't mind getting a shot at the doctor.
I won't watch the doctor give me a shot.
No, my Bob doesn't either. He doesn't.
So you were fine with it.
But doing it yourself, I mean.
Well, yeah. I mean, it became, because you have to understand, when you're sick and there's one thing out there that will make you better, and at first I was sniffing it, and you need more to sniff to cover the sickness if you shoot it. It's cheaper. Like, you get more out of, you know, more bang for your buck.
Right.
And you need it. You'll do whatever you have to do not to be sick. Because I got to go to work in order to pay for my addiction, of course. Because it's so hard to stop because of the physical withdrawals. I can't stress that enough.
Hey, we're talking to Joe Putignano.
John's fluent in Italian.
Only this name. Who is the author of the book Acrobatic. The book talks about two near-death experiences. Mm-hmm. It also talks about your eventual reconstitution and rediscovering yourself. You know, something that struck me as a question that I think I probably know the answer to, but can you ever take a break from being you? And what I mean by that is, is your guard going to be perpetually up now? For the triggers and for the things that could lead you in that direction again. And so, you know what I mean? You're never free of it, right?
Correct, yes. It's always something, in the same way a diabetic, though, has to take care of themselves on a daily basis. You know, for them, it's medication. For me, I do 12-step, which works. So that reminds me who I am and what I do without treatment. So I do. I have to be vigilant.
And actually, your answer pretty much cleaves with the notion of disease.
Mm-hmm.
The very first example you give of a diabetic, that's a condition. It's a medical condition.
Right.
And that's one that requires monitoring and maintenance. Yes. So that's the theory, and that's how you address this now.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's all mostly 12-step thinking is it's chronic, fatal, and progressive disease. Just like diabetes, if you don't treat it, it will get worse and kill you. So it's something you have to treat every day. If I miss a meeting, I'm not gonna like bust open a vein or anything like that. But I start to go into that mode of perfectionism, self-doubt. You know.
So what saved you?
Oof. I honestly still don't know the answer to that. I thought of myself. I was 29 years old. I'd been on Broadway. I had left the New York Times, performed with Twilight Tharp, all that stuff. I was sober for a year and a half, did the Bob Dylan, Twilight Tharp thing. It was amazing. And then I relapsed on her show right here on 46th Street. And I had been sober for like a year and a half, almost 2 years, and I loved it. And so I thought, like, you know, do you want this life or the new one?
Right.
So I had to go back to 12-step and raise my hand and say, I have one day, which is shocking, which is very difficult for any addict. And that's the only flaw I think 12-step has. But really what saved me is I didn't want to die. I didn't want to live as a heroin addict any longer, really. I mean, I tried getting clean for almost 10 years.
Wow.
That was my job.
That's amazing. Now, did you take joy when you were doing your gymnastics? Did you actually get joy out of doing it?
Yeah, yes.
So, I mean, and I'm not talking the perfection thing, but just you're doing the rings, the pommel horse, and just that knowing that you can do that and do it well, you took joy out of that?
I still do take joy in it. I don't do it nearly as much, but it's like when dancers say they dance, they're on fire. Like there is something inside of me that is greater than me. And who doesn't love that? You know, it's a feeling of freedom. And I'll always miss it.
You had one of the, you were in I would say totem, but I heard them say totem. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, if you're Quebecois, you'd say totem.
I was just going to say if you're French-Canadian.
Although yeah. I found out it was Eastern European. I don't know. I'm all over the place. You were the crystal man?
I was the crystal man.
I've always been, I think a lot of people have, kind of fascinated by the whole Cirque du Soleil machine. How was that from a, would you ever go back to do something like that?
The real answer, the real answer is no. I am so grateful I did it and I pushed through it, and but I could not do it again. Knowing what I've gone through,
right.
It is all of you, every aspect. And we were a touring show, so you live with these groups of people everywhere you go. And Cirque kind of secludes you, you know. You live together, you go to the tent, back and forth. So it's like a tribe.
Right.
And after a few years, you kind of want to kill each other.
I really do wonder about that. It's performance, it's physicality at a level that it's not just seen doing a stage play or something like that. All right, so at the top of our interview, you said you're learning to be you're in training and studying to be a nurse practitioner.
Yes. Well, a little interesting. I got accepted to Emory in Atlanta.
Congratulations.
Thank you for the emergency nurse practitioner program. However, I moved there in April, and it was a $150,000 school, and was signing my student loans and changed my mind in return. So now I have to find a cheaper, newer school.
To be nurse practitioner?
Yeah, because, Emory's private college or university and has really high tuition, which is happening a lot now. We're seeing with all students.
That number is, it's
staggering.
I think you're smart to make that decision, because that, talk about having a weight on your back, right?
Well, thank you, because I still am like, did I do the right decision? So.
No, Tim and I talk about this a lot on our show. You can get a really fine education at an affordable price, affordable for you and whatever your situation is. It doesn't need to be. That's a lot of money.
It's a lot of money, yeah.
And I'm not. If you just amortize that out, you're looking at years of paying that off.
I'm assuming you're younger than I am or we are. But I came to the same conclusion. John and I had a change of career, and I thought I'll go back and get an MBA. And I went and talked to somebody at one of the elite private schools, and he said, do you really want to have a $225,000?
At this point.
Point in your age. And I was like, probably not. So let's think of something else. So, I don't think you made the wrong decision, but you need to decide for yourself, too, if what you want to do, which I'm sure you'll land on your feet. Can you do a headstand here?
I could.
Yeah, I'm not going to ask you. I know. Yeah, I was trying to see if I could. I was trying to see if there's a smile. See, I was trying to see if we could shake you. But we want to thank you for joining us. I want to, one last question though. What is the biggest misconception of addiction?
Good question.
That it is a lack of willpower. Because if anybody knows me and what I did for a sport,
right.
I am the most disciplined person and educated in addiction, but it doesn't matter. So it is a disease. It's a mental disease, but regardless, like, there is an obsession in the mind and a physical need for it. Once it's triggered or you take the first drink, you just can't stop. And I think people don't realize the power in that.
I had to learn that
great answer.
In a weird way. Years ago, I did a little bit of individual therapy, and then my therapist dropped me into a group therapy session with five other gay men. Two of them were struggling with addiction, and I would apparently sit there, and maybe I made a face, or maybe I was like...
Maybe.
We went to high school together, so he knows that maybe I did make that pay. But we came to a point where one of the guys in the group had a bad weekend. He had, I guess he would relapse, or he had done what he was addicted to. And the conversation's rolling, and I must have looked very puzzled, because eventually the therapist looks at me and he says, "You don't really, really understand this." I said, "No, I can't even fathom how you would go through these behaviors that if you were observing yourself as a rational third party without, anything clouding your judgment, drain the bank account, lose the lover or the mm-hmm. husband or the wife, destroy friendships, leave town, whatever it may be, get evicted. And the guys that were dealing with this problem and dealing daily with it, they just said, you know, just be glad you don't understand it.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you understand it, that means you might actually.
Right.
But I think what you said is great. And I think that that was the lesson I learned as well, was that it's not, you can't judge. And you can't judge it on this Calvinistic kind of, where's your willpower?
Mm.
You know, buck it up, you know. So is that a guiding thing on a daily? I guess the ability to forgive yourself is another big thing, too.
Yeah, it's taking time. I'm not entirely there yet. Like, I still go through moments. We all do. I mean, I think that's human nature, where we look at our past and say, wow, I really screwed up here. And I do that from time to time. Like, you know, I wish I wasn't a heroin addict and had wronged a lot of people. But in 12-step, we do make amends, which I think
yes.
is incredible. And we do get to go back and say, I'm sorry.
Is that a really difficult part of that?
Yeah, but it's very freeing at the same time. If you think about the people you have hurt, and most of the time you get good reactions, but sometimes you don't. Like, people are like, I never want to see you again. And I've had that happen.
And I guess you just have to absorb it, and that's part of that process, right?
Yeah, and that hurts, but that's, you know, at least I made an attempt to right my wrong. That's all I can do. And so as a living amends, today I have to stay sober for, you know, the mistakes I made.
Well, congratulations. We've been talking with Joe Putignano. His book is Acrobatic.
Highly recommend.
It's
Highly recommend.
It's a very revealing, honest memoir. It has triumph, despair, and at the end of the day, triumph. So it's quite revealing, and we
Publishers
appreciate
Weekly
you.
Said, a more powerful anti-drug missive would be tough to find.
Well, there you go, John. So did you
read that
right there?
Man,
that's the publicist's talking point. I was trying to fluff it. Anyway, thanks for joining us. We appreciate you joining us here on the Focus Group. It's Tim Bennett with John Nash. We'll be right back with some shop talk. Mm-hmm. Stay with us.
The Focus Group is brought to you by Volkswagen Golf Sport Wagon. With loads of cargo space, sleek design, the versatility of an SUV, and the maneuverability of a car, the Golf Sport Wagon is in a category all its own. Learn more at VW.com.
Let's make some money.
He's the business manager. Let him manage.
This is the Focus Group.
Champagne! Champagne for everyone!
Hey, welcome back to the Focus Group. John Nash with my good friend and co-host Tim Bennett. You can find us on iTunes, SoundCloud, Stitcher, Google Play, of course on YouTube. We would love you to watch the show, actually. We spend a lot of time curating graphics to amuse you visually. Now, let's get this right again. If you are listening on iTunes and you get our podcast, we want you to subscribe, like, and rate.
That's it.
That's it. Subscribe, like, and rate. There you go. Boom.
SLR.
SLR. Sounds like a TDK cassette tape, high quality.
Subscribe, like, rate.
Thanks. We want to thank Joe Putignano for coming in again, author of Acrobatic. So, Tim, we have a quick shop talk. This one, you found it. And whenever Tim finds shop talks, it's a lot of his personality is in these things. I think this is a fun one. And the headline reads, even a company known for overworking people is embracing sleep. What a great way to start,
yeah.
Right? And was it McKinsey was the company that overworks people?
Well,
because they're a consulting
companies
to overwork
right?
people, yeah.
The reason I, did you ever, well, you've owned your own companies.
Yeah.
So you didn't have to ever sneak away for a nap.
No. No.
Would you, though?
No, I don't nap.
You don't nap?
Nope. And you know.
God, there's nothing better.
Can I tell you who doesn't nap either?
Madonna?
Good friend of yours.
Martha Stewart?
Comrade.
The comrade naps.
The comrade learned how to nap, and she taught me how to nap, too. You know how it works? If she knows she needs a nap, she goes and she lays down, and she says, you're resting. She repeats to herself, take a rest, take a rest. Then she'll fall asleep for about 20 minutes, and she'll wake up. You didn't know this about her, did you?
No,
you should ask her about it.
You're both crazy. Well, I like you both, but I know.
You love us both, right?
I learned to nap in college, and I don't know why. I would always nap, and to this day I nap, or sometime. But my mother would put me down for a nap, I think. So between 2 and 3, I love a nap. Oh, my God.
Well, look, in Europe, it's the siesta. you know, like Spain, is it siesta, right?
In Southern Europe.
Southern Europe, right.
Is it that Margaret Thatcher said, don't ever share your currency with countries that nap in the afternoon.
Yeah. And that goes right to this quote from this article. We still view sleep as something that interferes with work. And so McKinsey, a big consulting company, did this entire survey, and they and when the author asked the McKinsey PR person if they had provided nap rooms and stuff, they didn't answer the question.
Right.
But anyway.
Well, the gist of the article is, and the reason I picked it was, you always have talked about work-life balance.
Yeah.
And so the important part here was companies, you know, forward-thinking companies, as people know, Google or Amazon, Amazon wasn't mentioned, but Ben & Jerry's, Zappos, Huffington Post, they provide areas for executives to have nap or to have quiet space. And I remember when I worked even at Subaru, there was a time once a month where they'd have somebody come in and do massages. But God forbid, no manager would ever go. It was always the
no managers
or above would go, but the other administrative folks would go, and it was seen as fluff. Now again, that was the '90s.
No. This is exactly what I wrote down. It's exactly what I thought when I was reading this.
Seen as fluff,
or almost, I expect management to have a clipboard,
right,
and have someone stand next to the nap room. Oh, don't worry, I'm just taking a census.
Yep.
Oh.
There was actually a woman at Subaru that used to stand and count when everybody. She'd write down with the phone director what time everybody came in to the building.
All right. So in that environment, offering workers the ability to sleep or take a nap or something, I don't know.
My note on this was, I think it's foolish, but I do think that you go to work and you work, and if they're working you 100 hours like McKinsey, that's a bigger issue.
That's a much bigger
issue.
Because
they should be more concerned by the fact that you do have life outside of work, yep, and you do need to have something else to occupy your time or deal with family or deal with friends in order for you to be productive, because you're not going to be all work. So I agree with you on work-life balance. I think taking a nap at work is ridiculous. I think it's foolish. And companies that do it, I think, are a little bit crazy and just trying to satisfy some sort of
need. I am dead convinced, and I wrote this down here, that using a nap room is the equivalent of the scarlet letter.
Yeah.
I just can't escape thinking that this is some way for them to ferret out.
You come in late for a meeting, your hair is out like
your hair is all, your product's not right, you've been laying on a pillow. And
now, I used to do a lot of work with Specialized bicycles. And every day, Specialized gives the employees, I think it's from 11 to 1, you get 2 hours to do whatever you want. So you could go home and eat. But most people, they had organized rides, bike rides.
Sure.
Or you could
hike.
That's
cool.
So there was exercise or an organized.
Where are they located?
Mountain View, California.
California, okay.
And I thought that was quite cool. L.L. Bean does something similar. So there are companies that say, you know, let's get out and blow off some steam. You did that in your own company. You said you would often say you do your best work.
I was often sent.
You'd walk away or go do something.
When I owned Moon City with Greg, I was often sent out
for a walk.
Greg would be like, okay, I'd be like, Greg, I got to figure out this problem. It was often creative. We would have the research in front of us, the creative brief from the company, and I couldn't come up with an idea, and Greg would say, go for a ride. And I'd go out for 2-3 hours, come back, and I'd usually have an idea, or 5, whatever, because we were paid to come up with a bucket, right?
Well, that was the biggest challenge when I did that work at that crazy salad works company. They were so ridiculous about strapping you to a desk. You'd be done with all your work at 1 o'clock. God forbid you wanted to take a walk to get a coffee or go out
to
get
lunch. You often said that.
They forced you to eat lunch together.
Yeah.
Which I hated. They brought in lunch so you didn't leave.
That Specialized bikes thing, Google does the same thing though. Google, they encourage their employees to spend some of their day on whatever projects.
Yeah.
It's a personal thing. It's something that entertains them. I find that to be better. If you're looking for sleep hygiene, as we call it now, like a good sleep hygiene.
Well, sleep hygiene, as who calls it?
Hygiene.
Is that what you said, as we call it?
I was using the royal we. it might not include you, but it was the royal we.
As we call it.
I wrote down, you want to get more sleep, you want to sleep more? Turn off the TV. Just less TV. Less TV. Do you know how many hours of, I can't even remember the last stat I read with the average consumption of TV a year for people. It's like, choose a show, time shift it, Netflix it, whatever.
Do you have a TV in your bedroom?
No.
You want one?
No.
Does Bob want one?
Nope.
No. You sure?
Sure. Yeah.
I love a TV in the bedroom. That's how I go to sleep. The TV on the whole time I was in Sonoma.
I know. The only, yes. And whenever we, I would meet Tim at his room in Sonoma to go out, and he had the TV on. I said, turn the TV off.
Nope.
No.
Leave the TV on when you're at a hotel. Makes it look like someone's in the room. I put the Do Not Disturb on, and I leave the TV on and the lights. Leave it look like it's occupied. It might be in the bathroom.
Okay? God help someone break in and take that iPad.
You'd be the first one to bitch about it.
I would be.
It's company property. Anyway.
Anyhow.
So we believe in work-life balance, but we think these nap rooms are crazy. Is that our consensus?
Is that our consensus?
So there's no nap rooms at Triberry.
All of Triberry is a nap room, but that's another matter entirely, isn't it, Tim?
Anyway. Hey, listen, thank you all for joining us here on the Focus Group. I'm Tim Bennett, as always, with my good friend, John Nash. Be sure to like us on all forms of social media, which we're branded at Focus Group Radio. Also, if you go to focusgroupradio.com, you'll be able to find all the platforms where we're available. And we want to thank our partner here on the Focus Group, Volkswagen. They've been with us for over 7 years. If you're in the market for a new car, be sure to check out all the great cars VW has to offer. John and I are especially excited about our cross-country trip this fall. We'll be going in a new Golf All-Track, which is an all-wheel drive wagon crossover SUV. So we're excited about that trip. Stay with us and look for us on YouTube and our other platforms next week. Have a good week, everyone.
The Focus Group with Tim Bennett and John Nash. We're all business, except when we're not. Listen each week over at focusgroupradio.com. Business radio should not be this fun, but it is.